This is something that marvels me about David's own brothers, David's own relatives, David's own father. Look at the kind of the statement that his own father makes when the prophet of God comes to anoint David. Look at the kind of the judgment that his own brothers make in the place of war when David makes a move or an attempt to face Goliath. This is a proof that David has been positioned by his own family in an area or a place they think that is where he suits, but they are wrong. Allow me to tell you this, it is not what you think. The only place that would work better for him, it was in a manger where he would spend time with the flock, where he would go throughout his life just smelling the stinking stuff and junks of the flock. But it is not what they thought. In real sense, David was a king. Inside of David was a man with the ability to face Goliath, a terrorist that had terrorized Israel for long. A terrorist, or what I would otherwise call an enemy of the children of God. They underrate him, yes, based on what they see about him or around him, but they fail to understand that David is a man whose shoulders is able to relieve them of the weight that is breaking their shoulders. Is a man who is carrying the peace of Israel, who is carrying the stability of Israel. Come on. Most of us have been underrated, underestimated, mocked, rated, graded, judged, you know, criticized, compared and contrasted among by the people we expected to invest in us. I'm sorry, some of us have been our pastors. Some of them have been our church elders. Some of them have been our relatives. Maybe because of the feeling that they were the right people to do it. Because of a feeling that we were not the right people to do it. It could be true based on your observation, based on what you are seeing. This boy is stupid in class, but it is not what you think. Life is in the hands of God. God is the one who gives life. And God is the one who makes men to succeed. It's not academics. I've seen men highly learned with masters working for the primary for dropouts. Come on. It is not what you think. How many times do you underestimate people? How many times do you talk about people? Come on, listen to me, my friend. Whatever you talk about people and whatever people talk about you, it might not be what they think. Let me advise you, Penina. It could be right that this Hannah you are talking of has approached her menopause. In other words, there is no vocabulary in relation to bearing a son in the dictionary of her life. But it's not what you think. Whatever she's carrying is bigger than an elephant. Whatever she's carrying is bigger than a mountain. And I'm sorry, Penina, listen to me. 99% of the church I pasture do not know your children, but they know this one man, a son to Hannah. Whatever we talk about people, it is quite discouraging. It is quite heartbreaking. It has really broken our hearts. Some of us have been on streets. Some of us have eaten junks and collected on streets junks. We have tested life on a bitter platform. We have eaten on a very bitter plate. And when people looked at our situation, some of them being our relatives, when they looked at the fact that we are fatherless and we were motherless and so we are on the streets, they said we will not make it in life. We will die immaturely like our grandpapa. We will not get married. We will not have husbands. We will not have wives. Today, whoever knew that that street boy that walked around the streets collecting and eating junky stuff, the one you mocked and joked around with and hated, he would be in Lancaster City sharing of the message of the grace. Whoever knew that that boy you positioned in that particular specific corner of failure would carry the anointing of God. Whoever knew that that child would have a day when he would also confess and say, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed and appointed me to speak good tidings to the poor, to set the captives free, and to declare the acceptable year of the Lord. Come on, friends. Stop despising people. Stop preaching about people's sons and daughters. You never know what tomorrow holds. We thank God you are rich today. We thank God you are well able today. We thank God you are swimming in money and riches of this world. It is true, and that is yours. We have no problem. We are not envious of you. But no, tomorrow you may not be alive. Come on, your children may need someone's help. And maybe the son of that poor man will be a successful man tomorrow. He will be the one to create job opportunity for your sons. Come on, Pastor, let me encourage you. Let me encourage you. That small church that is called the Kibanda, that is frustrating you. In fact, at the end of the month, it becomes you to pay the bill. Because the 300 members you have in your church, there are 300 problems. There are people who praise themselves. If they buy your suit, they claim that they are the ones who bought it for you. It is okay. It is okay. Don't die down. Don't close down that church. Some of us could go to church and worship alone while people stopped coming to church. But we thank God today that they are competing for the chairs in the house. It is not what you think. May God give you grace to love people. Some of them may not be good, but may you have the endurance and patience to hold on, at least to educate people, to invest in people. Because tomorrow, you may need